Return of the Dark Wars. Time moves at different paces for different realms, so it is difficult to determine how much time passed in Dekeldor's home realm while he was in Limbo. Sources of Dekeldor's travels are not specific enough to pinpoint the exact details, but it is known that enough time passed for most of the living people he had known to have passed on. When he returned, he found the realm was again in the midst of a great war, and again it was caused by the organization that had started the Dark Wars. Unlike before, the organization had left their old realm behind and completely moved into Dekeldor's home realm. He did not know how they managed this without suffering the same displacement of physics he had, but that did not matter. What mattered is they had come with powerful technology, starships the size of worlds, and began occupying all of the planets throughout the plains. It was apparent from their command structure they were no longer run by the same leaders. Something had happened in their realm that had caused a toppling of their control there and forced them to retreat to Dekeldor's home realm. Once here, the half-demon beings that made up their armies turned on their masters and took over. Now they ran the organization under the lead of a familiar foe. Dark Destructor, whose body and head had been retrieved by the organization and put back together, was the leader of the half-demon uprising that took over the organization. They now referred to themselves as the Dark Wave, and vowed to conquer this realm and use its resources to once again conquer their own. Dark Destructor was much more powerful than before, seemingly imbued by a mystical energy of unknown origin. His hair was a living black fire. His aura radiated madness. This situation reminded Dekeldor of Limbo. Once again, a mad ruler was attempting to enslave an entire realm. Once again, no simple solution presented itself, as the enemy was inhabiting countless worlds also inhabited by those who needed freed. Once again, there was a familiarity to the enemy leader, though Dekeldor had never been able to quite figure out why he had felt this about the Shakarok. Once again, Dekeldor felt a personal responsibility to solve this problem. His solution came in the discovery of a being who called himself the Overlord. This being claimed to have originated from the same realm as the organization, and to have come through to this realm with them, but had done so inadvertently. He had been responsible for the overthrow in his realm, and had armies there that would defeat the Dark Wave easily. He simply needed a way to get himself and the Dark Wave back to his realm so that this could be done. Dekeldor's knowledge of portals from Limbo could easily be used to create a way back to the Overlord's realm. But to defeat the enemy required something more drastic. They needed to find a way to forcibly transport all of the enemy to their realm at once. The Overlord believed the similarity in the genetics of all of the enemy soldiers could be used to lock onto them with a device made to scan the entire realm. Such a device seemed beyond Dekeldor's comprehension, but the Overlord knew how to construct it. He would make a scanner if Dekeldor could construct a portal device that pulled the scanned targets into the other realm. Together, they created this device. While they worked on the device, Dekeldor got to know the Overlord. He primarily never showed himself out of armor, but when Dekeldor got a few rare glimpses, he verified that the Overlord was a skeleton-like man. His real name was Silverstar, and his ambition since birth had been to rule his realm. Dekeldor was uncertain that handing the realm over to the Overlord would be better than leaving it under the Dark Wave, but the realm he was handing over was not his own, so he gladly complied. The Overlord desperately wanted the device to work, not only to get him home to his realm, but because he felt defeating the Dark Wave now before they harvested the resources from Dekeldor's realm was critical to assured victory. He did not want the Dark Wave spilling into his realm in the future. He saw the partnership with Dekeldor as a necessary means to an end. Once the device was finished, it was used to send the Overlord home and also transported all the soldiers from the Dark Wave to their realm, with the exception of Dark Destructor. The Overlord and Dekeldor agreed to leave Dark Destructor for Dekeldor to deal with. The technology used by the Dark Wave was also left behind. With the Dark Wave gone, the people of the realm rose up and reclaimed their homes. They also used the technology of the Dark Wave to improve their lifestyles, and the entire realm became an advanced technological society, capable of travel between planes and across universes. The realm was now connected in a way it had never been before. Dark Destructor and Dekeldor faced off in an epic battle that no one would ever see. In fact, aside from Dekeldor's own memoirs, there is no record of his involvement in these new Dark Wars. To the people, it was as if one day the invaders vanished without a trace. After defeating Dark Destructor, Dekeldor took him to Limbo, where he was powerless. With the help of several other immortals, he imprisoned Dark Destructor in a stasis bubble, much like the Quasichni Trap, but without the altered time. This bubble was locked away and guarded by giant stone golems for generations. Returning to his realm, Dekeldor observed the people restoring their lives. He did not get directly involved. His time of gallivanting through the realm making wide sweeping changes was over. Limbo and the relationships he made there had changed him. He was far more mellow now and even felt a strange desire to protect these two realms. The Golden Era. Now that the Kildor's realm was interconnected and the planes communicated with each other, it was impossible to remain unnoticed. Though he had ceased ruling planets and shaping the lives of the people, a few of the more historically aware societies recognized him. He quickly became a public figure, though not a leader. Someone so powerful, who had once been so evil, and a hero, intrigued people. They sought his opinion on things related to the newly interconnected realm, and respected him for choosing not to lead with his power. To help keep himself from falling into old habits, Dekildor channeled his emotions into music. This was purely therapeutic, but it was eventually leaked across the realm. His music did not appeal to everyone, but there were enough people who resonated with it to afford him a lucrative career. Unlike in his past, when he had traveled the planes playing music to remain under the radar, he now traveled it in the limelight. He even released the same music in Limbo sometime later and was afforded a degree of fame there as well. Dekildor's life became one of constant travel, music, politics, and occasional engagement in battle against forces seeking to conquer his realm or Limbo. On one of the worlds he visited, Dekildor met a powerful sorceress named Misty Fortlight and had a child with her named Mikhail Dekildor. Dekildor taught Mikhail the arts of magic and spiritual power, hoping this would keep his son strong and alive, but it ultimately led Mikhail to hunger power. As he reached adulthood, he felt stifled by his father's teachings and refusal to claim power, so left to find power on his own. He eventually grew so strong he even found a way to grant himself immortality, a decision that would put him and his father on non-speaking terms for a long time. When Misty passed away, of natural causes, Mikhail blamed Dekildor for leaving her and not keeping her alive. In truth, he was angry with himself for leaving his mother. But it took generations for him to realize that. By the time he did, Dekildor had forgiven him for taking on immortality, realizing that to do so of one's free will did not result in the same hardships as his curse had. Both were projecting their own anger with themselves at each other, and had finally grown enough to see this truth. Throughout this time, Dekildor's music improved tremendously, and he became something of an idol. When he and Mikhail patched everything up, he invited him to go with him on a tour through Limbo, offering to help teach him to use his powers there. With Dekildor's tutelage, Mikhail survived travel to Limbo and regained enough power to feel like himself when he was there. Mikhail found he enjoyed life in Limbo more than in his original realm, and opted to stay. Dekildor did not blame him, but continued to travel between both realms for his music career and to protect both realms from outside threats. His life had become very busy and fulfilling in ways he had never realized it could. It scared him to admit it, but he was happy. Dekildor and Mikhail did not work together often, but when anything threatened Limbo, they and the other immortals who had once been part of the Order of Immortals combined forces to battle it. Several hundred years into Mikhail's life in Limbo, he, Dekildor, and several members of the Order banded together to fight a being known as the Arcane Lord. A monster that swallowed the souls of entire universes at once, the Arcane Lord was the sort of monster only immortals dared fight. It had even become so powerful that it could not exist within a universe without destroying it. The immortals fought it tirelessly, eventually banishing it to another realm where its powers did not work, and allowing the immortal from that realm to go there and finish it off. Events like this caused the immortals to quickly adopt Mikhail as one of their own. Elsewhere, during this same period of time, the spiritual power of the Shakarak pulled itself together again and entered the body of a young elf. He became the host of this power, but did not inherit any of the Shakarak's darker nature. He became a champion of hope and faith, a modern-day paladin, taking on the name Shakarak, out of a desire to redeem the name. Though his power was strong, Shakarak did not unlock the full power of the original being by the same name, until he met a warrior claiming to be from another timeline. This warrior, who dressed entirely in golden armor with a single tusk protruding from one side of his helmet, called himself the First Knight. He showed Shakarak the true power within him, but helped him avoid reawakening the darkness of the original owner of that power. Once done, Shakarak's body was bathed in brilliant golden light, and his hair became living flames on his head. It did not take long for Dekildor to meet Shakarak, and he became intensely curious about how he came to exist, and if he could be trusted. Shakarak claimed to want to protect the realms from threats, such as the former owner of his power, but Dekildor felt a need to accompany him to verify this. After some time, the two grew to trust each other enough that Shakarak let Dekildor taste his soul. He did this using a combination of his natural soul-absorbing and telepathic abilities. Dekildor discovered that not all of the original Shakarak's essence currently flowed through Shakarak. His darker nature was completely absent, and the power tied to that nature was absent as well. It seemed his lighter nature had become the new Shakarak, while his darker nature had entered someone else. Dekildor pondered who this could be, but the First Knight answered this query for him.
"You've already faced a foe with black flames for hair,"
the First Knight told him.
"A foe who shares much in common with you."
Dekildor immediately realized that Dark Destructor had inherited the other power. It was why he had become so strong when they had met after Shakarak's defeat. The dark energy had followed Dekeldor from his home realm and latched onto a natural enemy with similar desires and hatred for Dekeldor. He was glad they had imprisoned Dark Destructor now, but worried what would happen if Shakarok and Dark Destructor ever met. The First Knight calmed Dekeldor, explaining that he had made sure to awaken Shakarok's power while cutting ties to the darkness. The two forces would not become one again unless both decided to rejoin one another of their own free will. Dekeldor found the First Knight strangely easy to talk to. Every time they interacted, the First Knight behaved as if he already knew Dekeldor. He seemed to have a fondness for him deeper than any of Dekeldor's current friendships. He never let slip what their relationship was, only ever saying that speaking of other timelines can have grave consequences. Satisfied Shakarok and the First Knight could be trusted, Dekeldor returned to his music career. While on the road, he met a demoness named Taxus, who helped him indulge in a number of dark sexual fantasies, then disappeared as suddenly as she had appeared. He thought nothing of this at the time, but later came to learn she had singled him out specifically because she wanted a child with him. She needed a child born of an immortal for a special ritual, one that took a long while to prepare. She gave birth to a half-demon, half-strider girl named Nicole, and raised her in the harshest way imaginable. Over the years, Nicole was beaten and abused while being trained in the darkest arts of magic, becoming a scion of dark power. Around the same time, another half-demon child was born to a group of demons known as the Logar. The Logar were demons who rebelled against the Hell's Empire and lived in a lesser realm called the Underworld. Taxus, who was loyal to the Hell's Empire, worked to thwart the Logar, as they were a threat to the Empire's stability. She also sought the half-demon among their ranks for reasons of her own. By the time Nicole was nearly 8 years old, she had grown to despise everything in life with the exception of one thing, her father. Though she had never met Dekeldor, the thought that somewhere she had a powerful immortal father who would save her from her torment kept her from going completely mad. She worshipped a man she had never met, and did not even know the name of. Using Nicole as a weapon and the various spies she had among the Logar, Taxus slowly took over the Underworld until it caught the attention of Shakarok and the First Knight. They tried to intercede but were pushed back by the Logar, who were unwilling to see they were trying to help. In the process, they learned about Nicole and Taxus, and easily guessed the secret of Nicole's parentage. When they told Dekeldor he had a nearly 8-year-old daughter who had been abused for years by a demoness, he was furious. He joined them on their next venture into the Underworld, along with the aid of several of his immortal allies. Their plan was to rescue Nicole, destroy Taxus, and free the Logar. They did not arrive in time to do this. The initial interference by Shakarok and the First Knight had inadvertently revealed the location of the Logar half-demon. Taxus captured him, brought him to her home, and finally set up her ritual for Nicole's 8th birthday. This was everything she had been waiting for, the killing of a royal demon within the circle of the Underworld, while in the presence of a demon born of an immortal, would grant the being performing the sacrifice immortality as well. When Dekeldor, Shakarok, the First Knight, and their allies arrived, Taxus sent all of her minions to hold them off. She only needed a few minutes, and there would be nothing they could do. She set the ritual in motion, prepared the sacrifice, and was about to kill the half-demon when Nicole caught up behind her and brutally bludgeoned her to death. The thought of her mother abusing her for eternity was too much, and she had lost control in the moment. In the end, it was not her father that freed her. It was herself. With Taxus, a royal demon, dead in the circle, Nicole's body pulsated with dark energy. The ritual imbued her with immortality of a very similar nature to Dekeldor's. No matter what was attempted, she would never be mortal again, though her aging would continue until the equivalent of her late 20s. Dekeldor and the others broke through Taxus's forces and arrived at the conclusion of the ritual. Shakarok and the First Knight took the Logar half-demon back to his people and used his knowledge of what had happened to inform them of Taxus's death. The Logar routed out the spies who had once followed her and were merciless in their punishment. Within a few hours, the Underworld was freed. Dekeldor's allies protected Taxus's home to make sure no one entered until he and Nicole left. The two stood alone, meeting each other for the first time. He saw the darkest parts of himself in her. He saw what torment and fear does to a person. He saw an immortal with a long life ahead of her. He vowed to raise her himself and help her overcome all that had happened to her, no matter how long it took. To his surprise, she happily accepted and rushed into his arms. Dekeldor spent centuries with Nicole by his side. He continued touring and playing music, but included her in every moment. Raising her was the biggest challenge of his life, but also the most fulfilling. In the end, Nicole grew to become a brave warrior who overcame her beginnings and functioned even better in society than Dekeldor ever had. Though there was one hang-up she never got over. She refused to use the magic she had learned as a child for anything, and devoted herself to relying only on strength, speed, and guile. On a tour through Limbo many years later, Dekeldor learned of an academy for a secretive sect called the Reapers. Their leader, called the Grim Reaper, was retiring. This created a great rift in the sect, splintering it into three groups who were fighting over who would be the next Grim Reaper. If not for this fighting, their sect would have remained a mystery. But now the fighting was spreading across Limbo. Takedo was not interested in the sect or their war. He was more interested in the newly retired Grim Reaper. He arranged a meeting with him and was surprised to learn he was the same being who he had seen while in the Kwasinshni trap. He had called him the Angel of Death, but he now simply went by the name Dark One. Dark One claimed to be a fan of Dekeldor's and said he remembered seeing him in a dream long before he knew who he was. This, Dekeldor believed, was their visit in the Kwasinshni trap. The two quickly became friends, and Dark One became somewhat of a mentor to him, teaching him to harness and accept his inner darkness rather than repressing it. These lessons helped him with Nicole as well, and was partially the reason she was able to come into her own with time. When Nicole finally decided to go off on her own, Dekeldor spoke to Dark One again to thank him for his help. He was finally able to look on all of his life and see the value in it. He felt completely and utterly fulfilled. Dark One laughed at Dekeldor's newfound love for life. While he believed it was genuine and important, he knew this was far from the end of Dekeldor's story. "It's time for you to become involved in Limbo's politics," he told him. "The war of my former sect, that you've been ignoring, is now a place where you'll want to focus your attention."